This short video will review the basics of the origin of the periodic table and some of the vocabulary and ideas associated with the modern periodic table of the elements. The first widely accepted periodic table was published in 1869, and it was published by a Russian chemist named Dmitri Mendeleev. And this is a copy of the table that he published at that time. And what you might recognize here, it doesn't look like the modern periodic table at all, but what you do see are some recognizable elemental symbols. For example, here's hydrogen and here's lithium. You see sodium right here. And so he has organized elements in a way in which he has grouped them based on their chemical and physical properties, and he's identified their atomic weights in this table. So the reason why he organized the elements in that way, Mendeleev, here's a picture of him. These are his own words from his chemistry book that he published in 1905, over 100 years ago. "I began to look about and write down the elements with their atomic weights and typical properties, analogous elements and like atomic weights on separate cards. And this soon convinced me that the properties of elements are in periodic dependence upon their atomic weights." And this idea of periodic dependence based on their atomic weights is the periodic law. And the reason why it's the periodic law is because what Mendeleev was able to do when he organized the elements in this way was to predict that, based on this law, that certain elements should exist that had not yet been identified. For example, but here atomic weight 68 and 70 had not yet been found, but he was predicting that they should be there, and their properties should be somewhere similar to aluminum or silicon. Okay, and so the law was when a lot of the data fits into a certain pattern, then it has predictable power, and that's what he found. Now, zoom forward, 100 years, and we have what is the modern periodic table of the elements. It's basically his table turned sideways, and what you need to do is have some ability to recognize the different parts of the periodic table, and some of the important properties we'll look at as we move along through this semester. But basically, you should know that the individual columns are also referred to, the columns are called groups or families, and there's certain families, groups or families, those are the columns. And some groups or families have names associated with them, and you should be familiar with some of those names. For example, group 18 are the noble gases, and all of the elements in this family have similar chemical and physical properties. Group 17, so this is group 18 is the noble gases. Group 17 is what we call the halogens. You should remember that. Group 1 are the alkali metals, and group 2 are the alkaline earth metals. Okay, these are some common groups that are rather than being called by their number, sometimes are referred to as their name. You should also know that there are metals and nonmetals. The nonmetals are on this side of the periodic table, nonmetals, and you can see the colors associated with them, the green and the blue here. And then the metals are on this side of the periodic table. So we've got nonmetals over here, and you should know this, and metals over here. And the stair step in between are the metalloids. So metals have similar properties, and nonmetals have like properties, and the metalloids have properties in between. Okay, in particular, these metals down here are called the transition metals, and these are other metals over here called poor metals sometimes because their metal characteristics aren't as well defined as the transition metals. And then, of course, you got the alkali and the alkaline earth metals in groups 1 and 2. Down here, we have the lanthanide series and the actinide series. And the reason why it's brought down, this is called the short form of the periodic table as opposed to the long form. If you leave all of this long list of 14 elements in that spot there, it makes the table very, very wide. And these elements aren't quite as, their properties don't change as radically from one to the next as you move across, which we'll look at later. And so that a lot of times they're just tucked down here at the bottom of the periodic table. So it's just sort of an abbreviated way to make the table look better. Okay, so there's a lot of great periodic tables on the internet that you can look at on the World Wide Web. So let's take a look at this one. This is the one that I was just showing you in the static form, but it's a great resource because you can get information. For example, if you touch a particular element, it will show up here in this region right up here. Okay, whoops. So here's my calcium, for example, strontium. Whoops, whoops, whoops. Okay, and so we can see here is the noble gases are right here. And when I touch on this, you can see where the noble gases are. The halogens, like I said, are right here. Other nonmetals are listed there. Hydrogen, carbon, nitrogen, whatnot. The metalloids are listed in the stair step down right through there, the green color. Boron, silicon, germanium, arsenic, antimony, tellurium, and polonium. The alkali metals are what we call group one in the orange, the alkaline earth in the yellow. The lanthanides and actinoids. Lanthanoids and actinoids are sometimes they're called ides, actinides, and lanthanides are down below. The transition metals you can see there are in the middle, and then the post-transition metals are to the right of the transition but to the left of the stair step. Okay, and so we can see the actinide and lanthanide down here below. So this is these are the things that you need to know about the periodic table, where the metals are, where the nonmetals are. You need to know that on the periodic table, the number at the top of the elemental symbol right here is the atomic number, which is the number of protons. Of course, the elemental symbol, the elemental name. And then the atomic weight of the element. So these are all the parts of the periodic table that you should be aware of. And there's certain elemental names. You are should be responsible for most of the more common elemental names. You should recognize the symbol and the name for the more common group 1, group 2, group 17, 18, the common nonmetals here in the green, the metalloids, and most of the transition metals. Okay, you may want to go on and also read in your book and chapter 2. The first part of chapter 2 has a nice review of this information as well. Okay, good job.